I, Mrs. Vinita Kumbhar, welcome you all in this plenary session of 5th Bharatiya Vigyan Sammelan and Expo. Our today theme in this Shushrut Hall is Biodiversity, Forestry, Environment. Our session chairperson is Dr. Ganesh R. I request I, sir, to chair this session. Let me introduce Dr. Ganesh R, sir. His current position, current position is Professor and Head Department of Forestry and Environmental Sciences, University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore, India. PhD, University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore, India, 1983. Holding a prestigious position as Fulbright Fellow, USA, 1991. Fellow of Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi, 1997. Fellow, National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, New Delhi, since 2004. Honored with various awards like Parisara. I request sir to chair the session. To start with the session, so only one request for the speakers. As the schedule is very tight, each speaker will get 8 to 10 minutes. But
since there are only two speakers,
yeah. Okay,
sir. Okay. Yeah, I am Ganeshaiah from Bangalore. I have been working in the University of Agricultural Sciences. If I am here, the culprit is Dr. Yogesh Shoche. He called me one day and told there is a symposium here and I should come and speak on biodiversity and bioresources. The mistake I did was because Yogesh called me and I agreed.
Oh my God!
But I am also enjoying this because since he gave me an opportunity, I have driven all the way from Bangalore to Pune by my own car with my wife. Thankfully for this trip, I also now went to lot many places looking around for biodiversity. Yeah. And so I'm very happy to be here and nice to see that there is at least a good gathering for biodiversity. Can you come back like this? Because protection is the away. So we had scheduled 4 speakers, but of them only 2 have the other world chairman and another speaker. I know Shamika Mone for a long time and she has been working on biodiversity, especially on the traditional knowledge and the links between the traditional knowledge and the biodiversity. She is right now working on organic farming in Kerala, and she'll be speaking to us on diverse ways in which traditionally farmers have been keeping seeds and the way they maintain their seed diversity. Okay, please, Monica. You have enough time, don't worry, take your time.
Yes, thank you, sir.
And we will not allow the remaining two speakers to take up because they are late.
Can everyone see the screen? Because there are lights behind, I am just trying to come. So actually I would like to thank all the organizers who has given me the opportunity to come here and present in my home city. I have been presenting on organic farmers, traditional knowledge and their seeds elsewhere. But it feels different to express your work in your own home country, home city to be particular. To begin my story, I would just like to give a small this thing that I did my master's in biodiversity from Garhwari College, and later I chose to do master's in biodiversity. After that I went to different farms in Wardha, Goa, Karnataka, and now in Kerala. So in between, when I was in Goa office, can everyone hear me?
Yeah, can I hear? Yes. Don't please come to the front.
So when I was in the Goa office in Organic Farming Association, one fine day one organic farmer called to our office asking for traditional organic cotton seeds which are not contaminated with BT genes and no BT cotton seeds. So to his earnest question, I had no answer to his question, because all the seeds of cotton that farmers get in Vidarbha, where the cotton growing belt is, you get only BT cotton seeds. You don't get indigenous organic Deshi variety cotton seeds. So I had just no answer for his question, and then I started finding out where can an organic farmer, if he wants to source indigenous seeds, where can he get, where should he go first to find the native seeds. Then I went on searching, my project was approved, and then I travelled across the country documenting seed keepers, organic farmers and their traditional knowledge on seeds across the country. Now you might ask, what is the need for documenting? Come on, they are conserving and saving seeds for years together. What's the importance of documenting it in a book? What will happen with that? So one important thing I want to tell you that regarding Basmati, Basmati rice story you all must be knowing, hopefully. I hope so. I don't know your backgrounds, but in 97 we lost the case on Basmati. Even though Indians, Pakistanis and all Hindustan people were eating Basmati since ages, nothing was documented on a piece of paper to show that it has this much grain length, this much after cooking it becomes double the size or whatever, all its fragrance, all those qualities were not documented on a piece of paper, and we lost the case in 97. But the turmeric case we won because of the efforts by CSIR team scientists, and also because it was how do you say, documented in Shushruta Samhita, which was in Sanskrit. But as you all know, in European Union only six language European languages are considered as a legal language. Sanskrit was not considered as a legal language. But fortunately, a Harvard professor had translated that Shushruta Samhita document where the turmeric quality of antifungal properties were documented, and we could prove in the court of law that turmeric belongs to our area and it is our crop. After that, Basmati also was challenged, the patent over Basmati by a US company was again challenged, and there are some disputes still going on, but we is still on process. But turmeric case we won. So the point to tell is, there is, I show you the diversity that exists and you will get amazed by the diversity, as I got amazed, because there are thousands of traditional variety that farmers are conserving in different pockets of the country and nothing is documented. It's a most disorganized sector because farmers are not supposed to do that. It's our duty, like people like us who are research background, to go and do the compilation. It's not the farmer's job to do that, because when he is doing farming, he cannot do the research and documentation part. Now, I have become a farmer since last 2 years, so I know the difficulties of doing farming from scratch to the produce, to sell it and to finally get money in hand. It's quite a tough job. So, I forgot to tell you, now, do you know that this turmeric case and all the spices and things that I was talking about, after we won the case of turmeric, Indian Postal Service has made a stamp of turmeric spices of India along with chilies, cinnamon, cardamom. We never use these stamps. There are also stamps on butterflies and other forestry related things. We don't use that. It's only Mahatma Gandhi. I mean, I don't have any problem with Gandhi. I'm also a follower of him. But come on, there are different biodiversity things. Start using them. What are you doing? What are we doing? I mean, I have also not used it because I've not found it as yet. So you know all this, that there are 8 Vavilov centers of diversity, of which India is one of the center of diversity. I tried to document diversity of native varieties of crops and their varieties from these states. I could not go to the northeast, but we have many people there now, which I have known after documentation. My book got published in 2015. By Maneka Gandhi, it was published in Chandigarh in 2015. But after that, now I have so much information again that it goes for a second edition. But again, there is need of sponsorship and other issues still exist. There was also a debate, should one put this all in a compiled form or not? There was a debate that went on for 2 years, and finally the book came in 2015. Because many people said that if it is in a compiled document, any Monsanto piracy pirate can come and have it in one shot. But I feel they are much ahead of us, and if they want to do bio piracy, they would have done up till now. They will not wait for my kind of a book to come out. But this will definitely help farmers to know where the organic seeds are for their own production, because in organic you are not allowed to have GM or hybrid seeds. I tried to segregate farmers into different facets, like those who are organic farmers or farmer breeders, and they are just amazed by the diversity, and so they are conserving them. They don't care about what green revolution happened, what hybrid GM came, and so it's not about knowing all that, but just the beauty and the diversity of the seeds that they tend to conserve them. Some are the organizations, farmer organizations, scientists, environmental scientists who have come together and are conserving seeds. There are different tendencies of organized documentation, disorganized, different sects are there. Also, some are documenting the morphological characteristics of different varieties, how they are different. Some are not documenting. Some are selling seeds at the local level, some are sharing seeds. Like, I give you 1 kilo, next year you give me 2 kilos back. That kind of a system runs. So there are different limitations and strengths that I've documented in the book. Now I will go just state by state. This is in Chhattisgarh. There is a Dharohar Samiti. Dharohar, as the name suggests, you must be understanding that it's the conservation of local heritage, Dharohar. They are trying to conserve around 257 cultivars of rice, paddy varieties, all traditional varieties. I'm not here telling about the green revolution and how the traditional knowledge and seeds got eroded. I'm assuming that you all know that what happened in the 90s, how green revolution came in, how hybrids and genetically modified seeds came in, and slowly and gradually the speed of advertisements and marketing of seed companies have increased, and our traditional knowledge and seeds have eroded a lot. So conservation is with this background in mind. So as you can see, they're just keeping it in plastic bags in this case. But there is one farmer breeder who has conserved one Shiva Dharohar variety. It's basically made by selection process. These are all farmer breeders who have selected different varieties for different qualities, not only the high yielding character of a variety that they have conserved. Different facets are there, like some flood tolerant varieties are there, drought tolerant varieties, saline tolerant varieties are there. Some for the lactating mothers, there is some particular substance in that. Some have more iron content. I'll come next. In Gujarat, these are just the known people who are there, who are famous by now. But there are again thousands of them whom are not known, and they are in the backstage, which are not documented even. And in fact, when I started this, first I started searching for, there must be obviously, there are 20, 30 years, people are working, there are different NGOs working on seeds. So I thought there must be a book already available, why I should work on it. But there was not a single book like that for organic farmers or the budding upcoming farmers to know where I can source the seeds. So when I tried, this is in Gujarat. This is just a tip of an iceberg, you can imagine. In Gujarat, this is Rajnibhai Patel. He has basically worked on groundnut and wheat. In groundnut, he has developed a variety which you can see here. Not developed, it's a selection variety where you can see the root nodules. In the right side is his variety and left side is the university variety. Right side, he named it as Krishna variety. It has 49% to 52% oil content, which is higher than the university variety. And also in this case, you can see here, left side is his organic farm and right side is the chemical farm. You can see the difference in the green color. His brother is still not convinced about organic and he tends to do chemical. But this Rajnibhai Patel is actually doing a lot of organic formulations, and he knows the solution for all pest problems that are not documented here because it's only about seeds. Then there is one more, it's called a lost case study of Gujarat, because 20 years back, this he is Amrut Bhai Patel, the older man, and Ramesh Bhai, he works in Shrishti. They run, now also it's a part of National Innovation Foundation, where they tend to encourage farmers and local people's innovations in different ways. So 13 years back, they documented all the traditional knowledge in Gujarat, what kind of seeds are there, from 215 villages in 15 districts, and information of around 646 local varieties were there. So I was very fascinated. Oh, so you documented everything. I don't want to do anything. I just want to take a book, copy of that and put in my book. Then he told, this was 20 years back that we had done. We had no sources to follow it up later. So in the last 20 years, when the hybrids came, genetical modification seed companies came in, they could not sustain the pressure and force of these multinationals. And now in Gujarat, hardly any of these 600 and whatever land races, nothing is there. Very few, handful of people are conserving some, and they're trying to develop local varieties now from scratch. But this all is traditional knowledge is lost. It's just on paper now, but no seeds in hand. This is Samant Bhai Jada. He wanted to grow again an organic cotton without any BT traces. He tried to find the local variety to start with, could not get. Then went to university, so finally said, okay, if not an improved variety, let me get a hybrid variety. Hybrid variety, but not non-BT, but hybrid. I hope you understand the difference. And he back-crossed two varieties, taking lot of efforts. And now, after 8 years of his research, now he has got a variety. Which every time he keeps on checking the BT traces with the testing kit. There's a testing kit for checking the residues of BT gene. And now he has developed two varieties. People can order seeds. I have given his phone number and things in the book. So people ask him because there is a lot of demand for cotton seeds without any GM traces in that. It's okay. The next is in Kutch. It's the organization name is Satvik. And here also one problem was that high yielding varieties don't grow much in the very adverse conditions because you want to put lot of chemicals, but the soil is not suitable for lot of chemicals. Then people have a notion that traditional varieties don't yield much. Farmers want high yielding varieties. So basically farmers were very confused in this area. So this organization Satvik have worked hard to develop around and validate 67 traditional varieties which will grow in different ecological zones in Kutch. In Kutch there are very different things like extreme arid, semi-arid kind of areas. Now this is in Jharkhand. This is just to show the ecosystem how it looks like. And here the farmers in Sundar Pahadi where I went. Very beautiful place. It's a tribal area and farmers there don't do organic as organic. It's a default organic traditional practices that they are doing over the years. They don't care if it's organic or certified or whatever. Here, this is my friend Shamik Banerjee. He was graduated in chemistry and did his master's in biotech, but finally landed up in the tribal community helping farmers to conserve their traditional varieties. So now in their seed bank, the local seed bank, they have around 72 traditional varieties of paddy, sorghum, kodo millet, barnyard millet, and many others. They are also doing characterization. The details I'll tell another person is there. In Madhya Pradesh, this is Babulal Dahiya. He is a conservator of folk literature, Lok Sahitya. He used to, he writes very well in Hindi and he has also found out different muhavare in Hindi which are based on different varieties. It's very interesting to see his work. So when he was finding, when he found out that the folk literature is dying out slowly, after that he found out that not only folk literature but the traditional seeds are also dying out. Then he started searching for traditional varieties in his area, local pockets and things, and found around 100 rice varieties in cowpea, millets. And now Biodiversity Board of Madhya Pradesh also recognizes him and supports him for his work. another person in Jambua district. The organization name is Sampark. I am skipping some now because it's too much, and maybe I want to give some time for others as well. In Maharashtra, maybe you know, this is Sanjay Patil, who works in Bayaf, Jawahar in Thane district, and again a tribal belt. They are doing trainings and they have also conserved a lot of traditional varieties of paddy. Now they are also doing nutritional analysis. Now these are two local farmers who work with Sanjay Patil. They have also developed two varieties. One is called Ashwini and another is also doing this. Sorry, I don't remember the name. But they also developed two local varieties. And you can see the diversity. This is the corn diversity, sorghum diversity, wild edibles on the left side. They always do a yearly seed festival, biodiversity seed festival. And this is Vasantrao Futane from Ravada, is Samravati district in Vidarbha region. Here also, I am also part of his group, where in Nagpur we have a youngster group now since last 5 years. We are doing seed organic biodiversity seed festivals since last 5 years, and now it's catching up in cities as well. Many newcomers, farmers, consumers are getting linked up, because the main problem is that they're conserving seeds, okay, but who is going to, if I multiply them, somebody, there should be a demand from consumers to know about the organic seeds and the traditional varieties. If the demand is not there, there's no point and they will not sustain in future. Then other grassroots organizations like Lok Panchayat and Grameen Yuva Pragatik Mandal, they are all part of the Maharashtra Gene Bank, which you must be aware. The state is working on conserving traditional varieties with all these organizations. Now the Grameen Yuva Pragatik Mandal is working in Chandrapur and Gondia districts, while Lok Panchayat is in Ahmednagar. Kobragade's case is a very unique one. We call him the HMT man. He developed a variety called HMT. And he went to the university telling that this is my variety, I have developed it, please recognize it. They took 5 kilos, they said okay, give us 5 kilos, and then said that your variety is impure. And after a few days, they released one variety called PKV-HMT. According to the farmer, PKV-HMT and HMT, there are no differences whatsoever, but university claims that it's their variety, they developed it, and this is a very famous story of biopiracy nowadays, and it's also coming in textbooks, I've heard. I have not seen it myself, but as a biopiracy case, this is being showcased. The Ramesh Sakharukar from Amravati. Now this is Odisha in Nayagarh district. He is a traditional farmer conserving varieties since 98. Now, here I would like to take some time, Dr. Debal Deb. He is a scientist turned farmer from West Bengal, now shifted to Orissa 3 years back. He started a traditional seed bank of paddy. He has now in his collection around 1,100 varieties of paddy from all over the country. And he conserves all the varieties on just 1.8 acres, or say maximum 2 acres of land. Now can you imagine, how can you grow around 1,100 varieties in just 2 acres of land? So he developed a lot of floral asynchrony. That's a common knowledge that farmers used to have. 3 days plus or minus, the adjacent varieties should not be plus or minus 3 days flowering in the neighborhood. But for doing that for 1,000 varieties, he used to take 4 days and 4 nights to chalk out a map, who should be next to whom. So then one IT professionals came and helped him develop the software. So now he have to just enter the variety names and the flowering dates, and he gets a map in a click. So such help has come. He does rice characterization of each and every variety. Around 60 characters of rice he tries to characterize. And he has made it farmer friendly, very farmer friendly. A farmer has to just, it's a pick up options. He tries to make science very simple. Like even if you want to measure the length of a grain, he does it only with a graph paper and magnifying glass. You don't need a micro caliper for that. And you can get still the accuracy up to 0.3 decimal points, depending on how many grains you measure. And he has the bamboo microscope, as you can see. And this is his office in a tent on his farm. That's his office. And there are many different scientific papers that he has published. This I have taken this, where you can see the nutritional analysis of different paddy varieties that he has done. The most interesting one that came recently, and the name is very interesting, Garib Sal. As you know, the name of Garib Sal, Sal is the cover, and Garib Sal. And you can see that it has higher content of silver. Higher content of silver. And lot of other medicinal properties are also there. There are, it's not here mentioned, but I know of two other varieties where we did the same nutritional analysis from their lab. The varieties are from Kerala. The beta carotene content is very high. Now people are spending $1,000,000,000 to develop that golden rice, which is being promoted in Philippines. You have your traditional knowledge right there with 1,000, it comes in the Kerala chapter. And we still want to spend thousands of varieties to develop GM seeds. You have to decide if it's really required or not. So this is the diversity of paddy from Odisha. One more Sambhav farm, where they made it possible to grow organically on a very dry, stony area. In Punjab, almost everything, all traditional knowledge and seeds are lost. They are starting from scratch. In Rajasthan, most of the diversity is there. Now this man has conserved around 154 bajra varieties. We have stopped eating bajra nowadays, but in Rajasthan, bajra and makke ki roti is very nice. This is just the diversity you have to see. This is cluster bean, gawar, and mustard. Again, mustard, there is no need of GM mustard coming in because there are different things. I will not get into that story. This is also in Rajasthan, but here the problem was that before conserving seeds, they had to conserve soil in the first place because soil used to evaporate, get flown away because of the wind erosion. And so they conserved grass species to conserve the soil. Then this one more friend in Rajasthan. They have developed an organic outlet called Banyan Roots. They try to make interesting things out of ragi so that the normal consumer, citizen consumers can get encouraged. Like they have ragi noodles, they have ragi biscuits and all sorts of ragi things. We don't need to go to Maggi for having noodles. This is in Uttar Pradesh. The diversity of sorghum varieties you can see. This Vijay Jardari is a pioneering man who started the Beej Bachao Andolan in Uttarakhand. Now here I just don't want to see, his diversity is so amazing. Like Rajma, how many colors of Rajma shades do you know? I only knew red till I went there. And now you can see in Badami color also there is this much diversity. Violet color diversity, green color diversity, red color diversity, white color diversity, yellow color diversity. Now this is Kaupi, Nauranga it's called, Naurangi. Different organizations working on seeds. Andhra Pradesh, this is very important, DDS, Deccan Development Society is doing. On Makar Sankranti, if you have time, you have to go 14th January to this place. They beautifully decorate the carts with indigenous seeds and the food is amazing. They have a millet hotel run by the local women. Local women run a radio station and also do shooting of their local knowledge, all done locally. Now the Biodiversity Action Plan also recognizes their work and considers as a national model. Now this is Coorg, diversity of mangoes. This is from the Mandya district. He has actually got that place from, he is the grand fourth generation of Tipu Sultan, Sayyid Ghani Khan. He also conserves around 600 varieties of mangoes and 300 varieties of paddy. It's an amazing place to visit, again if you are in nearby Mysore. Cotton varieties developed different areas without BT traces. Sahaja Samruddha is one interesting organization in Bangalore who has also now started a producer, seed producer company. They give open pollinated traditional vegetable seeds along with paddy and other cotton and different things, but in you can also order in bulk. It's the only producer seed company of organic in India. We do different seed festivals in different areas. This was in Chandigarh last year. Annadana is also in Bangalore. If you are in Bangalore, this is again a nice place to visit. they also conserve vegetable seeds, open pollinated. Her things are a little costlier for a common farmer to access, but for the city consumers, they are the best. Now this is Vanastri again in Malnad, Karnataka. It's a group of women farmers doing excellent work on seeds. Green Foundation again in Bangalore and associated villages. This is a crazy lady about, she's a crazy about millets. This is in Kerala. Jaikrishnan is one of the farmers. And it's amazing to know how farmers in Kerala are aware. Now I am there since last 2 years, so I know the impacts. But when I went first time 5 years back, I was called as a Monsanto agent when I tried to document. Yes, just 2 minutes, sir. This is the diversity in Kerala. This is a tuber man in Kerala. He conserves around 300 varieties of tubers. Now this is Thanal Save Our Rice campaign. You see just this aerial view of the vineyard. They are conserving around 219 varieties of rice. This is Nammalvar Ayya from Tamil Nadu. He has generated now a young team of activists and people who is growing every day. He passed away 3 years back. Auroville Deepika, I'm just running through the slides now, I'm sorry. Diversity of vegetables. And this is the National Seed Savers Network that we have formed in the last 4 years. We meet after every 1 year and discuss points to which acts and how to follow it up. Now this is all documented in my book, which you can access online on Other India Bookstore, which is in Goa, Mapsa. And the details are there if you want to access the book. And thanks. Thank you for seeing me.
Deepak Bagul is Gram Panchayat member, he is tribal person, he is the first person in the village. We have passed BA and now he is working, studying in MA, and he is working on biodiversity also. And we are engaged in experimenting or experiment in Aurangabad district, where we have faced lot of drought since last 4 years, except last year. And on that background, we have started our experiment on community biodiversity park, which is for community participation. This is a model where we are trying to establish a model in future where community participation in conservation and protection of biodiversity and eco restoration on individual forest aggregation land. This is a model, it is under process, and within 3.5 years, initially there were 2 trees. Now during that these 3 years, we have tried to plant 227 trees, where 23 species are there. And after 3 years, we have observed lot of changes where we have established a biodiversity park. And that experiment, our colleagues are going to present in front of you. If there is any queries in understanding Marathi, I will explain in English. Please, Deepak.
मी मराठीत बोललं चालेल ना? तर जयविविधता पार्क, तर औरंगाबाद जिल्ह्यातील वैजापूर तालुका आहे. तर या ठिकाणी आधी खूप प्रमाणात जंगल होते. तर हे संपूर्ण जे जंगल आता नष्ट झालेले आहे, कमी झालेले आहे त्यातलं प्रमाण, तर परत आपण ते कसं उभं करू यासाठी आम्ही एक मॉडेल एक म्हणजे अडीच एकर एरियावर हे परत वनस्पती जे संपत चाललेलं वनस्पती त्यांची लागवड करून परत जतन करण्याचा प्रयोग करत आहोत. तर शेतकऱ्यांच्या शेतावर सन्मानजनक उपजीविका आणि जैवविविधता व परिसर निर्माणासाठी लोकप्रिय विकसित करीत असलेले एक मॉडेल. तर यामध्ये जैवविविधता व परिसर निर्माण विरुद्ध भीषण दुष्काळ म्हणजे मागच्या 4 वर्षापासून भीषण दुष्काळी परिस्थिती असून सुद्धा आपण त्या ठिकाणी 2.5 एकरावरचं जो आपले काम आहे तर गाव कम्युनिटी आणि संस्थेचे काही कार्यकर्ते अशी मिळून पारळा जुळवणे जैवयुक्त खडकाळ मुरमाळ कोरड्या 1 हेक्टर जमिनीवर लोकपर्याय विकसित करीत आहे. 2011-15 या सलग 4 वर्षाच्या मराठवाड्यातील भीषण दुष्काळाच्या पार्श्वभूमीवर नुकतीच लावलेलीची रोपटी जे रानभाज्या वेली आदी वाचवण्यासाठी 2 वर्ष पाणी विकत घेऊन किंवा गावातील हातपंपाने पाणी उपसून आणून ते झाडांना आपण ते 2 वर्ष जगवलेली. प्रारंभी केवळ त्या पूर्ण 2.5 एकरामध्ये फक्त 2 झाडे होती, 2 प्रकारची झाडे होती. तर आता त्यात 1.5 वर्षाच्या काळात 207 झाडं आता सध्या जगलेली आहे पूर्ण. त्याच्यामध्ये रानभाज्या असतील, वेल्या असतील, गवत असेल आणि ज्या संपत चाललेल्या ज्या वनस्पती, तर या वनस्पतींचा समावेश त्यामध्ये आहे.
Second is wood. Medicine is for agricultural equipment. Nobody you know. And now you can see 207 villages in dry land. It is completely totally dry. There is no moisture in the contained in the soil. Rocky soil. Murim is only half to one inch murim there. Now after 3 years, you can observe 44 species of trees. You can observe 6 crops which are productive. There are 35 medical plants. There are 43 fuel wood plants. There are 30 fodder trees where leaves are used for the as a fodder. There are 8 species of grasses. And 8 kinds of grasses. You can see 12 trees where their wood can be used for agricultural equipment. There are 7 trees where you can use wood is used for construction. There are 16 ranbhaja, that is forest vegetables. I never use wild forest because there is a concept of bankruptcy. These persons are wild, they are like by animals. Thus, we used to say that this is wild food. Actually, it is forest food. So that's why we use ranbhaja, the Marathi word. Ranbhaja means, ran means forest. Ranbhaja means vegetables. That's how we used to use word forest vegetables for ranbhaja. There are 16 ranbhajas. There are 6 other trees which we have to identify some. Then there are 6-10 insects. One animal, that is 4 snakes. 11 types of birds. 11 types of village level fishes, traditional fishes. 2 crabs. And 1 frog. This is a change in 3.5 years. That is a tremendous change. That's how we used to say that from 2 trees to 27 trees, then you can develop eco-restoration biodiversity. It is not the plantation of trees. It is development of entire nature, entire biodiversity, entire eco-restoration. Chal pude.
सन्मानजनक उपजीविका आणि जैवयुक्त परिसर निर्माणमध्ये लोकांचा मोठ्या प्रमाणात सहभाग आहे. त्यामध्ये जनसमूहासोबत विचारविनिमय आणि नवनवीन प्रयोग करणे, महिला, आदिवासी, दलित, भटक्या, विमुख युवक युवतींचे प्रशिक्षण व नवीन नेतृत्व निर्मिती. 12 गावातील सुमारे 70+ शेतकरी आपल्या शेतातील डांग व पोट खराब जमिनीमध्ये 33 जातींची विविध झाडे लावून ती वाढवित आहेत. 13+ जातींची सरपणासह औषधी झुडपे, 22 प्रकारच्या गवताच्या जाती, 17 जातींच्या वेली व 18 प्रकारच्या रानभाज्या शेतकऱ्यांनी सांभाळल्या आहेत. त्यांची उपजीविकेसाठी खास उपयोग होत आहे.
यू कॅन सी अवर पिक्युलरिटी इज दॅट अवर ऑर्गनायझेशन वे आर डेव्हलप्ड एक्सेप्ट माय सेल्फ माय वाईफ शी इज माय कलीग बोथ आर आउटसाइड अस फ्रॉम बॉम्बे बॅक कम देयर बिफोर 40 इयर्स व्हेन आय वॉज 21 नाउ आय एम 62 and this is the 3rd generation. I was brought there from their parents. He is tribal, he is central caste. And now their 3rd generation is with me. And we are trying to develop local leadership. She is Mangal Sonani, she is tribal also. And that's why it is sustainable. That work is sustainable, that concept can be applied on the ground level because of the local leadership. They are from the soil. And she is Mangal, she collecting ranbhaja vegetables, forest vegetables from the that biodiversity park.
सन्मानजनक उपजीविका जैवविविधता व परिसर निर्माण आणि सामाजिक प्रश्न ऊसतोडणी वाहतूक करण्यासाठी वर्षातील 7-8 महिने स्थलांतर करणाऱ्या भिल्ल आदिवासी भटके विमुक्त समाजातील कुटुंबातील मुलांची बाल आनंद जीवनशाळा या शाळेमध्ये आम्ही जे ऊसतोडीला जाणार स्थलांतर करणारी जी मुले तर त्या मुलांसाठी बाल आनंद जीवनशाळा सुरू केलेली दारू भट्ट्या व दारूबंदी विरुद्ध जोरदार मोहीम जनसमूहाचे अधिकार व कर्तव्य सर्वांना शिक्षणाचा अधिकार यावर सतत प्रचार मोहीम बालविवाहाविरुद्ध निरंतर मोहीम त्यासाठी मुलांच्या 12वीपर्यंत शिक्षणाचा पालकांकडे आग्रह कुटुंब सल्ला केंद्र जनसमूह केंद्रित न्यायदान व्यवस्था लोकमाहिती केंद्र
आवर बेसिक अंडरस्टँडिंग इज दॅट अनलेस अँड यू हॅव स्टार्टेड युअर ॲक्शन्स ऑन सोशल इश्यूज रिलेटेड टू कम्युनिटी like we have started Balan Jivasa, that is childhood care and development center at Parla, where we have established biodiversity park, and we are trying to give all facilities from October to May when their parents are migrating towards Gujarat, towards western Maharashtra as a harvest labor. All our tribals and nomadic types, all these girls and boys are with us for 9 months, and this is a social activity. Anti-liquor activities also there. We are trying to establish one rule that to curb the to minimize the to eradicate the child marriage system from the society. Campaigning is necessary there, but only campaigning you cannot restrict the child marriages. That is old system. That's why we have tried to apply our own rule there. You have to educate your girl up to 12 standard. It means up to 18 year. Once she crosses 18th year, once she passed 12th class, she will not listen their parents or you or me. She will start to go ahead. Then we have started to bring that girls to Aruba city, and we are trying to give them tribal facilities, and after that we can restrict their child marriages, and we have succeeded in it. He has passed MA now. That our colleague Mangal, there she has three children, one boy and two girls. Three children are living in Aurangabad city, tribal reform school, and both the parents, mother and father are working with us as a full-time worker, and they are developing the biodiversity park there. They are staying there. That's why we can run that school, not formal school, that is a typical hostel, not typical hostel. Jivan Shala, we used to say Jivan Shala, Ananda Jivan Shala, Bala Ananda Jivan Shala. That is not for restricted for 4 walls. So that couple is trying to give up all facilities to the children. And that's why the ladies, girls are also secure there. Such social activities, anti-child marriage movement, anti-liquor movement, we are trying to implement Forest Right Act since 2008. Our movement is there for 40 years. I came there from Bombay during 1977. We got Forest Right in 2011. Then we started this movement. Biodiversity park. It took near about 37 years to getting the forest land. That's why it is easy to convince the people to establish the biodiversity and ecosystem on your field after 37 years, and after the handling these social issues, then we have established family counseling center. The conflict between husband and wife, the violence in family, other issues we are handling there. We have established people's information center we are going entire information about the government scheme, tribal department scheme.
भविष्यातील ज्या योजना आहेत त्याच्यामध्ये गौण वनोपचार उपजीविकेसाठी पळस फुलांच्या नैसर्गिक रंगाचे ग्रामीण उद्योग मॉडेल एक अभ्यास हा आम्ही भविष्यात आता सध्या सुरू केलेला आहे. ओ टी एस पी क्षेत्रात सामूहिक वन जमिनीवर सम्मानजनक उपजीविका जैवविधता व परिसर निर्माण करणे आणि संरक्षणाचे व्यक्तिगत लोककेंद्रित मॉडेल उभे करणे. भविष्यातील योजना क्रमांक 2 जैवविधता व परिसर निर्माण करण्याचे खालील ठिकाणी उपक्रम राबविण्यात येतील. पारंपरिक धार्मिक ठिकाण, वन जमिनीचे कंदुरीचे जागा, देवस्थाने, पाजर गाव, साठवण सिंचन तलावांचे पाणलोट क्षेत्र, नालाबंडी, शाळा, ग्रामपंचायत कार्यालय, गायरान न व कसलेली जमीन, जमिनी, अंगणवाड्यांचे जागा.
इज युअर प्लॅन इन फ्युचर? बट आय विल नॉट एक्सप्लेन ऑफ, वी आर कॉन्सन्ट्रेटिंग ओनली डेव्हलप बायोडायव्हर्सिटी पार्क ॲट पार्ला व्हिलेज. यू आर ऑल्सो ऑल आर इन्व्हायटेड टू व्हिजिट अवर प्लेस वेअर वी कॅन गिव ठेचा अँड वाजरी भाकरी. थँक्यू.
Last talk, perhaps. I will take the last 30 minutes. And yeah, thank you very much. Request some of you, all of you to come this side. Otherwise, I have to turn my head 180 degrees every time. All of you can come this side, please. Yeah. I am not going to talk anything of the data collection or any of the documentation that she spoke about or of the conservation. I thought to the youngsters here, I will now speak something on how we can learn a lot from our history on the way we need to conserve our bioresources. I prefer to now speak on this especially because I saw that the theme of this symposium is the confluence between the ancient science and the present modern science. So I thought ancient science is going back into history. So what is that we can learn from the history? Now let me now start with this image of a hermit of our ancient sages. We know that these ancient sages were all in the green surroundings, and if one has to now reconstruct a model of a hermit, it perhaps looks something like that. But if you go back to some of the tribal areas today, you see that the hermit image is still now maintained, and perhaps we still have a lot that we can now perhaps connect the history and the present. The other thing that you all know is about the fact that in every village there will be a ficus tree, and this again stresses back to our history. Now all this shows that there is a love for our vegetation, and the love for our vegetation is instinctive, and we have seen lot of such instinctive power working within India. And this love for greenness is in fact perhaps for our own good. And how is that is one for our own good? I like to now talk here about a small experiment done by a lady from Netherlands. Her name is J. Maas. She has published this work very in very important journal called I forgot. Now the work goes like this. You know, in these poor countries there are reports of morbidity, stress, depression, anger, anxiety, sometimes going mad, and extreme cases of people losing their entire life by killing themselves. This kind of morbidity is very common in the cold countries. And Netherlands is a very cold country, and there almost regularly people will be going for the doctors to be now advised on the difficulty they are facing. Now she contacted these doctors, and these doctors gave her data on about 345,143 people who actually were going for this kind of morbidity reports. She collected the data and analyzed the following. Now why are these people morbid? Or is there any link that we can perhaps see between morbidity and the amount of vegetation or biodiversity in surrounding areas? So the proportion of green space within 1 kilometer of each of these cases, she now began to examine. And what is the result? The result is the following. she tracked 15 diseases and she found that all these 15 morbid diseases were lower in areas whenever in the surroundings there is more vegetation. And it is very particularly true, she found, with respect to children. In other words, if I had to now draw a graph, if on the x-axis I take the proportion of the green space around the houses within 1 square kilometer area, and on the y-axis the probability that you become mad, it turns out that you are less likely to become mad if you have vegetation around your houses. And this is the Netherlands data, and perhaps it will be true with anyone else also. Now, know that morbidity is a mental disease, and the mental makeup and the mental health and the health of the human beings in other words seems to be depending upon the graves. And no wonder in the hermits people were very happy than in the palaces in the past, because in the hermits there was a lot of greenness, and you know the people in the palace only know how to now fight with others and develop the bad habits of the kind that we have ever heard in the history. In other words, it appears that there is a lot of link between the vegetation around us and the way we now find happiness in our life. Unfortunately, today what is happening is the happiness is not defined, you only define the development. And we all think that if you have more cars and more GDP and more grass for national products, the country is very improved, but happiness is not. If you now look at the happiness and if you look at the human life, it appears we need to have vegetation, we need to have biodiversity. Precisely the principle that Jains have followed in India for a long time. Unfortunately, we are not now respecting back the spirit behind all these religions, and we are not all respecting the rationale also behind all these religions. Perhaps Jainism has experienced this, and so it is now led to a situation where you will see that Jainism respects almost every organism equal to itself. Perhaps that is one way of living happier. In other words, nearer to the nature, nearer to biodiversity we live, and more healthier we are, and so we need to now conserve biodiversity, conserve nature. So one other element that I want to bring about from this example is that I spoke about the parks and I spoke about the advantages of that. That is, if you have a lot of green around you, lot of green parks around you is advantage for you. Lot many times people ask me the question of what is the difference between biodiversity and bioresource. This example perhaps now tells us the difference between them. Park, just for the sake of park, is biodiversity, and the park, if it gives a lot of advantage to us, the knowledge of it is bioresource. So the same park becomes bioresource when we know how to use the park, when we know the uses of the park, and we also begin to use the park. So the bioresource that I am talking about today is, in other words, biodiversity whose use is known to us. Now, I would like to now take you through 4 or 5 examples depending on the time. I will keep myself the time because I am the chairman and I would like to now cross the time. I will perhaps end by 4 o'clock. Now, as you saw now, we found that greenness and vegetation can improve our human life and human health. What I am going to do is, in addition to that, give examples of how this greenness or this biodiversity can help in our human survival and human civilizations, how the same biodiversity can also help us in building up the empires and civilizations, and also an example to show how sometimes cities are also lost because of the fact that we don't care of our resources, depending on the time. Let me now take the first example of the Vijayanagara Empire. I'm sure all of you know about Hampi, isn't it? I'm sure all of you know about it. The capital of the Vijayanagara Empire, and Vijayanagara Empire was one among the most richest empires in the entire world after Rome. If anyone says which is the richest one, is Rome, and after that people say, historians say, Vijayanagara was the most richest empire in the history of the world. But we started asking the question of what led to the emergence of the second richest empire in the world from Vijayanagara. We don't know about Rome, but Vijayanagara is sitting just neighbor to us, and we know about history, and what is the reason why this Vijayanagara became so famous? There have been number of civilizations, but we now thought, let us ask this question with Vijayanagara, which we know very much about. Generally, if you look into the history, the general answer given is that, oh, Vijayanagara was full of diamonds and gold, and so people used to measure diamonds in them, you know, in those puddies and safes, and it was so rich, and so Vijayanagara was very famous. Note that an empire cannot live by eating diamonds. An empire cannot live by respiring diamonds. You need something beyond diamonds for you to now live. So could there be any bioresource that we can think of that probably led to the survival of this empire or the emergence of this empire? So we found out there are three other resources, biological resources. One is sandalwood, other is spice, and third is red sand. I am going to tell you how these three contributed to the emergence of this empire called Vijayanagara. Now, if you look at the distribution of these three resources, of course I told diamonds are important for the empire because you need resources to now build up your army. Now, and diamonds were located in that part of the Vijayanagara. The yellow shade or the green shade that you see in India is the empire's boundary that was known to have been spread around in, as per the historical details. And if you look at sandalwood, almost 80% of the sandalwood distribution was located within Vijayanagara. And then if you look at spices, I don't even know tell you that our spices were available along the coast, west coast, and Vijayanagara was in fact having its dominance along the west coast, you know, starting from Kanyakumari to almost the Pune or Gujarat area. But of course, Vijayanagara ended somewhere around Pune and not beyond that. And the fourth important resource was red sandals. All of you may not know that one of the famous kings of Vijayanagara was Krishnadevaraya, who is an Andhra king, and he took a daring pilgrimage to Orissa area where he was about to be killed by the daughter of a king. He took that risk and no one knew why he took that risk. He could have actually now lived in Orissa in the same area where he now came about by, but he now went, he took a lot of risk to actually take care of this area and no one knew why he actually went there. Let me also tell you, history says that after he owned the Orissa area, where the ladies were known to be so brave in their fighting nature, he came back to Tirupati, and Tirupati was his religious god. He is supposed to have now dipped Tirupati idol in 30,000 coins in which Tirupati's idol was, you know, printed. That means he respected the win over Orissa so much that he knew that that was a very daring war. But why did he go there? The reason why he went there is because of the fact that there was red sandals there, and red sandals was one among the important resources. I will tell you the reason why these four are important later, but let us ask this question. I am arguing that these are the three biological resources that led to the emergence of Vijayanagara Empire. But someone like you, who is very young and very rational, might ask me the following question. These resources were there in the past also. They were there in South India for a long time to come. Why only Vijayanagara Empire had to now dip and has to come up to the peak using these resources? Why were the people before that did not use these resources had come up?
It turned out that the reason why Vijayanagara came up to the top of the historical peak in terms of itiness is because exclusively for this reason that Vasco da Gama landed in India in 1498 and he provided the opportunity for the Vijayanagara people to now utilize these resources. And what is that opportunity? Let me tell you. Vasco da Gama came there in Kerala and he came in 1498, went back and again came back in 1502, and of course others followed him in 1505, and with that in the coast of India there was a huge business opportunity that was created. Business opportunity for who? For the Vijayanagara kings. And Krishnadevaraya, remember, was crowned during 1510. So within 10 years of this opportunity that was created when the Vijayanagara kings came, Krishnadevaraya took over, and Krishnadevaraya had a very brainy minister, and he knew the advantage of dealing with the Portuguese who came from Europe. And in fact, his minister also made a small deal with these Portuguese people. Look at the last point. They had one beautiful sister to a king called Veera Narasimha. They gave this sister as a bride to one of the Portuguese princes and developed the bondage so much so that the relations actually became strengthened. And all this was a strategic plan to ensure that Vijayanagara people now develop relations with the Portuguese and the Europeans. Why was this relation developed? The reason is that at that time Vijayanagara kings wanted two things from the Europeans, the guns and the horses. And what did the Europeans wanted? Please know that Europeans were sold out for our spices, they sold out for our sandalwood, and they were sold out for our Indian, especially pepper. Pepper was almost like a gold for the Europeans. Ever since the Greek, they were also, the tongue of Europe was sold out for our pepper, and so they very much wanted the pepper. But where was the pepper going to Europe? All through the Arabian middlemen. And Arabian middlemen were cheating both the Indian and the Europeans. I will not perhaps go through
too many of the details, let me tell you what kind of cheating they used to do. As you know, Europeans were very belated people about the geography of India. And Arabians were cheating them a lot. And they did not know where these spices are coming from. They knew somewhere from the east, but they did not know where. And these Arabians used to tell a lot of good stories to them. I will tell you one story they used to tell. So when Europeans asked the Arabians, where are you getting this carbon from, where are you getting this pepper from, the story they built was the following. There is a huge peak somewhere in the east. On the top of the peak, there are huge birds as big as elephants. And these birds are very greedy. So we know actually cut a lot of goats and sheep, go and now throw it in the base of the peak. The birds come, they are very greedy, they carry this meat and put into their nest. And they are so greedy that the nest by their weight actually dropped down. And the bravest of our young man run there and carries the fecal matter at the base of those nests. And this pepper and taran is the fecal matter of the birds. And this was the story that was given. And they believed it. And these Arabs were cheating the South Indians also, especially Vijayanagara people also. How is that? Vijayanagara kings wanted the horses and guns, and they were getting all that from the Europeans. And what is that they were telling? In fact, there is a book by a Britisher on Vijayanagara, the Forgotten Empire. If you read in that, you'll get a lot of very good details. If a Vijayanagara king wanted 100 horses, they used to buy only 50 horses in the Europe and get the remaining 50 tails of the dead horses, come back and show it to the Vijayanagara king. You see, we bought 100 horses, but on the way remaining 50 horses died. Here are the tails of the dead horses, you have to pay for. And this is how they used to cheat the Vijayanagara kings. And for 100 Denny sacks of pepper, they were only now giving one horse. For 100 Denny sacks of pepper, they were only giving one horse. And that 100 Denny sacks they used to take there and buy 100 horses from the Europeans. So there were no cheating on both the sides. But when the Europeans came directly in contact with the Vijayanagara kings, they could now shake hands with each other. Vijayanagara kings also came to know that they are being cheated by the Arabians. And after shaking the hands, they could deal directly with the Europeans the source of the guns and the horses. And Europeans also found that they can get more pepper for the same guns and the horses by now dealing with these people. And so the bond between the two increased. As a result, what happened? Vijayanagara's military strength increased. Vijayanagara's military power increased. They had more guns and more horses. In fact, there is a statement in that book on Forgotten Empire that is, just to now make sure that the Europeans don't sell the guns to Adil Shahi in Bijapur, Vijayanagara kings used to give them 20,000 pounds every year. Just for the agreement that they should not sell the guns and the horses to Adil Shahi of Bijapur. In other words, guns and horses were atom bombs for Vijayanagara, and spices and condiments were drugs for the Europeans. And both could come together, they could shake hand and buy the drugs cheaply from India, and these people could buy nuclear bombs easily from the Europeans, and so the strength increased. As a result, I'll skip because of lack of time, and of course, sandalwood, was also very important for them, because the frequency of bark that they used to now have was very less, and let me skip all of that. So, Vijayanagara wanted guns and horses, Arabs were cheating them, and as a result, the two traded. Especially Vijayanagara kings trade with the Europeans. And what did they trade? These bioresources, the sandalwood, the spices. And in turn, what did they get? They got the military power. So, with the military power, they now started spreading in the whole of that area. In fact, you all know that Vijayanagara kings even went to Sri Lanka. And similarly, there was the red sandals. Red sandals was being used for preparing a lot of ethnic and religious idols. Even today, you might remember that in the Krishna Janmashtami, the idols are prepared out of these red sandals. And the red sandals were very famous in China and parts of Arab also. So it was very valued at that time. So as a result, they could now harvest all these three resources and sell them to the Europeans, build their military strength and become strong. Generally, if you read the history, the following is told. What is that? Vijayanagara kings and the Bahumani kings fought in 1565, and in that war, Vijayanagara kings lost, and from that time onwards, Vijayanagara did not cover. No, hundreds of wars were fought between the two, and several times both had lost. But never earlier, Vijayanagara kings had lost. They lost in 1565 purely because by that time, they had actually lost control over the same resources. How is that? As we all know, once the Britishers came, the diamonds were discovered in South Africa.
in 1564. So the bargaining power of the diamond went off. And the spice cultivation was spread by Britishers all over South Asia. So the bargaining power of the Vijayanagara people to now sell the spices at the same rate as they could went down. And sandal was monopolized. What is the meaning of that? I'm sure she would know that for a long time in Karnataka, sandal was banned to be now sold by the private people. So what people, smugglers used to do is go to Kerala, cut sandal and bring it and put it into Karnataka, or cut the sandal in Karnataka, take it to Kerala and sell that into our sandal. Britishers used to do the same thing. Because it was monopolized, Vijayanagara kings could not actually sell the sandalwood and so they lost control over the sandalwood also. As a result, after 1565, the control over sandalwood was gone, control over spices was gone, diamonds were available elsewhere, the bargaining power went down, so Vijayanagara kings came down. In other words, Vijayanagara was built up purely because of these resources, and once the control over the resources went up, Vijayanagara empire went down. Thus, the emergence and decline of an empire, you can see, is linked to these resources. Generally, we believe that, you know, Hitler built Germany, or Kishindevaraya built Vijayanagara, or Ashoka built, you know, whatever he joined. No one can build purely by political will. In addition to the political will, you require resources. And the most important resources are the biological resources. Military cannot simply be sustained purely by, you know, having diamonds or wars. You need to feed the military. You need to maintain the horses. For all that, you need biological resources. Civilizations cannot be built in vacuum. And no political will can win any war unless there are biological resources to fuel all these, and thus biological resources are important.
Yeah, I have 10 more minutes.
So we have seen that biological resources are important for building empires and civilizations. Let us see another story how biological resources and mismanagement of them can lead to the destruction of entire civilization. Now the story I am going to talk about is a story of a small island called Easter Island. And where is this island? As you can see in the circle there, it is about 3,500 kilometers away from the mainland America. And it is called Easter because the British sailors who used to go, you know, cartographing the entire world, they now located this island on an Easter day in 1722, and so they called it as Easter Island. It's a small island of about 50 square kilometers. The surprising thing about this island was that when they landed on this island, there were no trees at all. Well, that would not be a surprising thing. Incidentally, there were about 200 natives in that area. The fact that there were no trees wouldn't have been surprising, but for another important element, and that is the following. All over the island, there were this kind of stone statues. And these stone statues, some of them are so heavy that you cannot imagine them to be moved from one part of the island to the other part of the island. In fact, all these stone statues were known to be carved at one part of the island, that is where the stone quarry was, and from there they have been carved and shifted to other parts of the island. Some of them have been moved almost for 16 kilometers. The question is, how could they have moved these heavy statues, some of which weighed even almost 100 tons, 16 kilometers, without any equipment? All this has happened around 400 AD. Around 400 AD, there were no instruments at all. There were no, you know, machines at all. And in fact, one engineer has calculated the kind of equipment required to now move even the cover of one of these statues. That is the kind of equipment he required. There were no equipments at all. So how did they move this? So paleontologists and people of the old great gentlemen sitting behind, they landed on this island, they went into the history of this whole island, and lot of things came about. Now let me tell you. Generally, we all know that for any of the huge statues to be moved, we need rollers, and the most usable roller at that time was trees. But on this island, there are no trees at all. So this paleontologist dug into the soil and they took the cores and measured the pollen grains available there and classified them to pollen grains from trees and pollen grains from the herbs. Now the red color that I am showing there is a proportion of pollen grain that belongs to the trees. As you can see, around 400 AD, when the natives landed there, there were a lot of trees that belonged to the trees.
Sorry.
Lot of pollen grains that belonged to the trees. That means the island was full of trees at that time. And gradually, as you can see, the proportion of pollen grains has come down. So in other words, from a situation where the island was full of trees, it has reached a stage where the island is having no trees at all. What happened to them? Incidentally, if you also track the population size, how do you map the population size? He would tell you that if you go and dig their thrown out pits and estimate how much of the food is eaten, accordingly count how many people are there, it turns out that their population size, which was in the very beginning just around few tens or hundreds, increased to almost 7,000s and brought back and collapsed back to just around hundreds. In other words, population has increased to thousands, and then the populations of the trees has collapsed, the population of the humans also has collapsed. What is this correlation? What has happened? They looked at the major tree pollen grains that are available, and they found that on the top left hand side, that is, these are the pollen grains of and the nuts of the trees that are available on that island. They took those pollen grains and nuts, compared all over the world, and they found that there is a parallel tree that produces a similar kind of pollen grain and nuts, and that tree is not there except in Chile, and that tree is called Jubia chilensis, a palm tree. Look at the trunk of this tree, perfectly made for rolling the stones. In other words, this island was having trees of Jubia species. We don't know whether Jubia chilensis or any other species. There was a species of Jubia which was perfectly made for rolling, and so they were in fact cutting this particular tree for rolling the stones. But what happened to that? What happened was the following. Incidentally, they were cutting this Jubia tree not only for rolling stones, but also for preparing huge canoes of the kind that I showed you in the previous slide on the right hand side. Why were they preparing canoes? I'll tell you. It turns out that these natives were having a lot of love for dolphins. Their major food item was dolphin. Again, from the pits they discovered dolphin bones. The important food they were consuming was dolphins. But how do you get dolphins? By going deep into the ocean. To go deep into the ocean, you need huge boats. And so they were cutting these trees to go into the deep ocean. They used to hunt the dolphins, but gradually, as trees went on cutting, they could not prepare the canoes. And because they could not prepare the canoes, the bones of the dolphins disappeared from their food items. And now they cannot go deep into the ocean. They can only eat the crabs and fishes in the surrounding area. They now finished those fishes and crabs also, and they now started eating birds. 6 species of birds became extinct, and about 12 to 15 food birds were locally extinct, and then they turned to the lizards. They went on eating lizards. Lizards are also eaten away, and they also became extinct. So the population now is now without food because they can't go into the ocean. There are no dolphins. Birds are eaten away. Lizards are eaten away. So a population of around 7,000 fought among themselves. Civil wars broke down. There are 2 kinds of people, long ears and the short ears. Short ears remained the long ears. The short ears remained there, and that collapsed to just around 200 people when Britishers went there and saw this tribal people. In other words, mindless exploitation of one species, that is Jubia species, led to the destruction of entire civilization. Generally, lot of my non-biology colleagues ask me, what if, you know, so many trees are disappearing, anyway you want vegetation, you want food, every food is there for you to now eat. We will not realize what element of our biodiversity perhaps is, you know, important for us, for our own survival, this because we would not know how much of our civilization depends on what species, as you could see from this story. I'll skip all that. I don't have time to now go into other stories. I'll stop here. Eventually, what I like to now end up in telling you is that I will skip this story. We need to now perhaps remember history and learn from that. And there's a famous saying that those who forget history are condemned to repeat it. And the few examples that I told are only to now tell us that exactly fitting to the theme of this particular symposium, that we need to know much the past science and the present, or the past history has to be a lesson, I mean a teacher for us in learning lessons. I have now brought in 2 examples to show how history can teach us about the importance of bioresources, and not only we learn, we need to know perhaps follow it up by telling that we need to have this kind of models and that kind of data that she proposed to conserve our biological resources. Thank you, and all the people will be happy to know answer any questions. Please come. Okay. Please come here. Don't make me stand alone here. Yeah, any questions to her or to him or to me? Any of you can ask.
Not the wars, it's not anything else. Exactly at the time around 1565 when the major war took place, the Kimberley diamond was recovered, mines were recovered in South Africa. So that diamond quality was better than the diamond quality here. Not only that, the advertisement for that diamond also went down increasing. All over the world, demand for Vijayanagara glass diamonds went down. So the bargaining power of Vijayanagara people with the diamonds at the Gunsat also went down. Number two, Britishers now began to colonize all over Southeast Asia. They also harvested spices from Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, etc. They also began cultivating spices, and so the value of our spices went down. And number three, they monopolized on sandalwood. Wherever sandalwood is there, they claim it is theirs. They cut it and take it to their territories and claim it is theirs. So the value or the purchasing power through sandalwood also went down to Vijayanagara power. And so the military dissolved, and so they could not win the war later. Generally, history teaches a lot of lies.
This is a combination of all.
It's a combination of all. Because as I told, there are almost 100 wars fought between, Adishahi, Bahmanis and Vijayanagara people. Several times Vijayanagara has lost, several times Bahmanis have lost. But never ever Vijayanagara went down. It went down in 1565 because the purchasing power, the economic power of Vijayanagara had gone down because they lost control over all the resources. Any other questions?
I have a question to you. So you told you publishing the book, right? Is it possible to digitize that?
Yeah. If you are ready to digitize that, we can help you out. You can also take the whole book, the digital part, into the iBeam database. I would also like to tell you that there is this database called Indian Bioresource Information Network, where all this kind of database can be put into there. We will be happy to put all this database into there. Of course, the due credits to you, all the credits to you. Let us now talk about it.
Please,
you can discuss with him.
Send me an email.
Yeah. And if you are willing, everything goes on your thing. So any data point that comes from you will be now what we wanted to do.
Book
also we have made it a copy left, book copy. Okay. Where all the farmers and their knowledge, they are also part of the copy left.
Book is very good, but
for growing youngsters who do not know the book, not only for the smartphones, sometimes digital books and digital data are very important. Yeah. There are no questions. Thank you all, it was wonderful being here. I am very happy that there was a good gathering here. Thanks to some of the seniors who have been here. So, thank you very much.
Hey,
madam.
Sir, sir, sir. Okay. Sir, apan sarancha felicitation
karu.
Yeah, you also come here. Yeah, I want to take a photograph.
On behalf of Fifth Bharatiya Vidyan Sammelan and Ferguson College, I would like to thank Shri Dr. Ahia sir for very very interesting and immensely informative speech. I would also like to thank Mone ma'am and Pandere sir for their speeches. And before I conclude, I want to felicitate Ahia sir. So I request Pandere sir to felicitate me with the memento.
Can I have a free word here, madam? Can I felicitate an old man who has done so much work?
I'm not an old man.
No.
Your
work is wonderful, sir. Yes.
Great. And moment is wonderful.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.